Chimney Swift.
She used
Chimney
to be a baseball
Swift?
Player, and she always used to say, "Sock it to me."
Folk blues, you know. I was a folk singer, you know, and sang blues, mostly country blues, old-time blues. Slow. Big.
Didn't you have a job soldering once?
Soldering?
No, a key punch operator.
It was a matzo ball.
I was a waitress in a bowling alley once, too, baby. Playing is the most fun there is. Feeling things and really getting into it.
Crotty.
That's fun.
At that time, there was definitely a sense of camaraderie. If you knew the Grateful Dead had a house on Ashbury, that, you know, it would be unlikely that if you were in the neighborhood, you'd just drop by and hang out with those guys and smoke a joint or something like that. We were all sort of riding the same wave, in a sense, all part of the same scene and all shared in some ways the same values, that we were part of this counterculture, revolutionary music thing that was gonna, you know, change the world.
She was just funny, unassuming, sexy, and sort of a kind of like almost a sort of Huck Finn innocence to her. The absolute child woman ideal of the Hate.
Well, I met Janice as a romantic interest for one of my bandmates, Pigpen, Ron McKernan. We call him the Mighty Pig. It was an on-again, off-again little affair that they had. And on the nights that Janice would come over and visit, I got very little sleep because Janice was not real quiet in the rack. And so all night long, it'd be, "Daddy, Daddy, Daddy," and all that kind of stuff. I mean, but endlessly.
Isn't Pigpen cute? They make Pigpen t-shirts now with his picture on it for fans. I have one in red. Those people are all friends of mine. Aren't they amazing? The people with stars after their names are members of the band. I'm in the back, on the left. Really an amazing picture. They aren't dressed up. They look that way all the time. Now, taken in perspective, I'm not so far out at all, eh?
There was a party. There was a party in the city at an apartment on California Street. Someone opened this bottle of this stuff. It's called Cold Duck. You don't see it around much.
Sparkling wine.
Sparkling wine. And it started to go around the room, and people were taking chugs of it. And Janice took a big swig of it. And someone said to Janice, "Oh, man, you must really want to get high." And she went like, "What?" You know? And so I said, "Yeah, there's like, you know, 60, 80 hits of acid in that bottle of Cold Duck." Anyway, she ran into the bathroom and tried to throw up. But she got very high anyway, and we went from this party to the Fillmore. Otis Redding was, I think, in his second night, and it was the second show. They did two shows, so there weren't a lot of people there. And I remember sitting with her. We sat down in the middle of the floor, and Otis Redding came out with his band. I think when she saw him and saw the way he moved and how he interpreted a song, I really think it very much affected her. I mean, literally, she started doing this gotta, gotta, gotta. She stole that.
Billie Holiday, Aretha Franklin, now they are so subtle. They can milk you with two notes. They could go no farther from A to B, and they could make you feel like they told you the whole universe. You know? And Otis, Otis, my man. But, I mean, I don't know that yet. All I got now is strength. But I maybe if I keep singing, maybe I'll get it. That's what I think.
from you yet, but I'm brimming with news, so here I am. Last weekend we played in the city, and a man from Elektra, a good label, spoke to me afterwards. Rothschild feels that popular music can't continue getting farther and farther out and more chaotic. He feels there's going to be a reaction, and old-fashioned music, blues, shuffles, melodic stuff is going to come back in. Well, Elektra wants to form the group to be this way, and they want me. Wish I could ask someone for advice that knew and wasn't biased for any reason. Ah, dream on. Janice.
The women is losers. The women is losers.
We thought maybe we could get Janice to be more locked into the group. I took her down the hill on a little pathway here through the woods and talked to her all about this stuff. And a lot of what you would say the American dream of most girls in the 50s and 60s was about came out at that time. She said, you know, I've dreamed about all this stuff all my life, being on the cover of these magazines and, you know, having a fancy car and, you know, living in a fancy home. And I don't know what to do. I mean, you guys are good and stuff, but I mean, and I said, you know, a lot of that stuff was bull****. And give us a chance. Give us a month.
Bobby Shad from Mainstream Records, he offered us a deal, and so we signed this bad record contract. And at the same time, in doing so, we were kind of locking in Janice, and that she knew what she was doing, that she was in some way locking herself in with the band for at least a few years.
It was good that she stayed with us because we let her alone. You know, we weren't talented enough to get in her way. You know what I mean? We weren't strong enough. But those guys, you know, Paul Rothschild, and you know, they would have eaten her alive. You know, they would have shoved her over in the corner. As much as you could shove Janice in the corner.
In the very beginning, she didn't, you know, take over as I'm the singer, I'm the lead singer. She really tried to integrate into the band and be part of it. The big turning point was Monterey Pop.
A very good friend of mine said, you've got to come to the Monterey Pop Festival. There's never been a pop festival. You know, you're going to have a great time. It's a weekend. It's in Monterey, California. Simon and Garfunkel were going to perform there. And that's all I knew about. So I came there with my khaki pants and a tennis sweater. And I was astonished by everything that I saw.
I got a call from Lou Adler, who was the producer of Monterey Pop. He was also the manager of the Mamas and the Papas. He told me they're holding the Monterey Pop Festival. Will Big Brother come? I saw the future. He offered me a number, and I went for it. I didn't give a damn about the money. I knew that this was going to be a monster.
So I vividly remember sitting in the grounds there, being surrounded by this unusual crowd, and then they announced the group.
3 or 4 years ago, I ran into a chick in Texas by the name of Janice Joplin. And I heard her sing, and Janice and I hitchhiked to the West Coast. A lot of things have gone down since that time, but it gives me a great deal of pride to present today the finished product of 3 or 4 years of work, Big Brother and the Holding Company.
We had been told about Monterey Pop that it was going to be a big party and everybody's playing for free and no one's going to make any money. And then all of a sudden there's a movie being made by D.A. Pennebaker and they're asking everybody to sign a release just before you get on stage.
I thought everybody in this country is dying to get out to California to see what's going on. And so I said, without even thinking, I said, sure.
Lou Adler wanted me to sign, as he had everybody sign, the contract for the movie. And I said no. And he kept on it, and I kept saying no.
There was a whole sort of San Francisco kind of contingent that was of the sort of philosophy that these L.A. guys are not going to make a movie out of our stuff. We're not going to be in your movie. We just came for the party.
There were 9 big machine gun cameras around the arena. All 9 cameras were pointed down to the ground. And as they're starting to come off stage, people are starting to tell them, this wasn't filmed, this wasn't filmed, this wasn't filmed. So Janis is really pissed off.
They got to Janis, John Phillips and Lou Adler and these people, and they said, look, we'll put you on again. We'll give you a second show if you'll be in the movie. And to make a long story short, there was a lot of infighting amongst the band and our manager, and eventually
Grossman was involved,
and
too.
Albert Grossman got involved.
I went to Albert and I said, Albert, I don't know what you have to do, but you better find a way to get her so that we can film her, because she's really critical to this.
This group we'd like to bring on now because of the great acceptance they had on Saturday afternoon. From San Francisco on Mainstream Records, let's hear it for Big Brother and the Holding Company.
Cass was sitting there in one of the rows, and I kind of had an eye on her during Janis, because they had been a little critical, because they were Los Angelinos, and the Los Angelinos were somewhat critical of the San Franciscans in terms of the bands. And so I kind of wanted to watch her when Janis sang.
Just looking at the rain. Some came along, honey grabbed a hold of her, and it felt like a ball and chain.
Once she got real recognition at the Monterey Pop Festival, I think she began to see what the possibilities were, and the possibilities were somewhat over the top.
Dear Mother, at last, a tranquil day, and time to write all the good news. I'm now safely moved into my new room in our beautiful house in the country. Gosh, I can't seem to find anything else to talk about. This band is my whole life now. I really am totally committed, and I dig it. Wanted to send you these clippings. Since Monterey, all this has come about. Did Port Arthur News have anything on these? If so, please send. I just may be a star someday. You know, it's funny. As it gets closer, more probable, being a star is really losing its meaning. But whatever it means, I'm ready. Things are going so well for me personally. I have a boyfriend. He's head of Country Joe and the Fish, band from Berkeley. He's a Capricorn like me and is 25, and so far we're getting along fine. Everyone in the rock scene just thinks it's the cutest thing they've ever seen, and it is rather cute, actually.
Oh, we were never in love with each other. No. No, there was no sizzle going on. We were good friends. We were both control freaks, both lead singers. There was a maternal, feminine side of her that never was allowed to grow. She was really trying hard, you know. And her mother was coming to town. She wanted to cook chow mein for her mother. She was so worried that her mother would like her apartment. And Seidemann had just made that poster of her with naked with the necklaces. We put them all up on the wall.
We went out to visit her, the Summer of Love, as a family. My brother and I were the only teenagers who probably went out with their parents.
You know, go see Janice, we're walking down the streets, and just she's showing us around, and I was so excited. Then we went to the Avalon Ballroom, and Big Brother was not on the bill that night, but they went on and did three or four songs. Moby Grape let them have a set because Janice's parents were there.
When we were getting ready to leave, I remember overhearing one of my parents tell the other one, "You know, dear, I don't think we're going to have much influence anymore." I think that her own telling of her story was about the ability to make your life fit your values. And she found that opportunity in the music world of the 1960s. The social acceptance that she'd always wanted was there, and it just propelled her forward. Fresh and so different for someone who'd been an outcast.
Sense that as long as people gave her the stage,
she would be a winner.
Sound, and if so, what is it, and how did it start?
The thing that makes this what they call the San Francisco music scene, as far as I'm concerned, is, like, first of all, the freedom to create here. You know, for some reason, like, a lot of musicians ended up here and ended up together and had complete freedom to do whatever they wanted to, and so they came up with their own kind of music. What do you think, Sam?
Not bad. Well, here we are together again at last by popular demand. How are you?
Yeah, I don't know what it was. We sort of hit it off right away. Was she romantically attached to me? I would hope so.
May I light your fire, my child?
I guess not.
Apparently not, no. Well, I would have bet against it myself.
We were good friends, and I will level with you. We may or may not have ended up intimate. I just, you know, my memory is so bad.
Or so good.
We lived in the Chelsea Hotel while we were making Cheap Thrills and while we were touring, and we lived in Los Angeles. About half the time we were in Hollywood and half the time we were at the Chelsea Hotel in Manhattan. And it was just so much fun. You know, we would get together and, you know, do heroin at these people's rooms and just kind of not, you know, nod off or go to sleep or something, but just, you know, have really nice, mellow conversations.
Tombstone quality for her. And so I was going to do a film with her because I really liked her a lot. And she was recording stuff with the band, and I would go and listen and film them. I was interested mostly in how she understood to control her singing, because her singing had this thing of when she'd lose it, she would shout and scream. And sometimes that was very effective, but it couldn't be, the music had to have something more to it than that.
Playing it and listen to it back ain't gonna teach us a damn thing.
Yeah, sure.
Man, I know exactly what that's.
Yeah, I did dig it. I did dig it the first time I heard it. Also, like the other one.
Yeah.
I mean, I think maybe an adaptation or a combination of two. Yeah, right. Because like yours had a lot of lyricism to it. This has nothing but.
You know what else? This is like an organ trip.
Recently in Life magazine, and I have a copy here, and I'd like to read what you were quoted as saying about your music. The audience sitting down is a weird trip. It's like separateness, but when they're dancing, they're doing it with you, like you said it to them, and they've got it, and you can play freer and freer. Would you care to elaborate on that?
It sounds different when you say it. It's sort of like you as a performer would understand, like an audience communicating with the performer, right? It's instead of like one giving and one receiving, it's like a reciprocal thing. When an audience is dancing, they're communicating with you, and you know that you're getting to them, and they're grooving, and you're grooving, and it's sort of like in feedback. Do you know what feedback is in amplifiers?
Yes.
When you play the note too loud, and the amplifier play it back, and you play it back, and it goes round and back, and it just makes everything go higher and higher.
I see. Well, that that clears it up.
Dear family, lots of trouble in the band, most of them revolving around the fact that I think I'm hot as I'm told by everyone from Albert down, and the band is sloppy.
When she came into the band, Peter was the leader of the band, the bass player. And James was the mythic, iconic, you know, beautiful figure. He represented the band. And then here comes Janice, and when she joined the band, she became both of those things. They had a very complicated reaction to her fame.
There was a cadre of hangers on that sort of insulated her from her band, from what I could see. And it was just a matter of time until somebody tried to polish her up and make a big star out of her.
It's crazy now to think back at it that we signed a management agreement with a guy. But I think from the very get-go, I think there was a sense that he was not a big fan of ours, that he really was into Janice. But we wanted to believe that he would work for the whole band.
And the guys in the band were powerless. No one had the ability to stop that from happening. She was a singularity, and she attracted that kind of attention.
She cared about Big Brother's career,
she loved those guys, but there was something that she saw that was beyond that. And if she didn't do it, she'd never know if she could.
Dear family, so we're back in California for 2 more weeks. After that begins my hardest task. I told you, remember, that I was leaving Big Brother and gonna do a thing of my own. There'd be a whole lot of pressure because of the vibes created by my leaving Big Brother, and also just how big I am now.
No, nobody ever saw her wearing those kind of clothes, but that's the kind of clothes she had when she came from Texas. You know, if someone said, well, what'd you learn from Janice? What did she teach you? If I had to say it in a sentence, it's emotional honesty. And the price of not emotional honesty, she started to lose that. She started to become something that people expected of her. She started to become a caricature of what she was and play it for people, you know? And I think that hurt her in some way. Take this lonely heart from one lonely girl. Reaching too high, babe, can't help from getting burned. Everything she ever wrote pretty much is autobiographical. I thought the reaching too high, babe, too, is right. This is done right at the time when she's leaving Big Brother. She knows she's kind of going to go for some higher level of fame and stardom, and, you know, she might fall on her face. She knew that. It might not work out. She might get burned.
The fallout for James and Peter and David was significant because Janice asked Sam to come with her to her new band.
I loved Janice. I loved her all the way through. You know, the first time I ever saw her, you know, she just had this attitude that I liked. It wasn't belligerent, but it was non-compromising. She's loud. She's, you know, one of these loud Texas women. She's real smart and considerate most of the time, you know. And we both had real quick tempers.
They called me up to play with Janice. So they sent me a ticket and I went to New York. I went there and they opened the door and this girl had on a bra and some panties and said, hi, I'm Janice. I said, hi, I'm in the right place. And she started singing. I said, damn, are you sure she white?
Then you quit Big Brother and the holding company. Why did you do that?
Well, just because it was sort of just time for us to, I think, to go on and do something else. You know what I mean? Like you grow together, you know, a certain way, and you sort of exhaust each other. You exhaust the good that you can do for each other, and it was just time for each of us to start growing from in other directions. You know what I mean? I think you really grow as a musician, and that's what we're, after all, we're supposed to be all about, is trying to get better at what we do, you know.
San Francisco was the first place, the first community where Janice really felt at home. When she left Big Brother, she lost it. Pressure to succeed was huge, and she was carrying around this weight.
know, she didn't know how to lead a band. That's one of the reasons it was a mistake. You know, she didn't know how to lead the band, and she was in charge. So she had people putting together that band for her, along with a lot of other strange people who were appointed band directors, you know. It wasn't working.
There are changes in personnel, and none of it solved anything. We went to Europe only like 2 months into touring. She's there with a new band which doesn't know what the hell it's supposed to be.
Okay, you guys. You know what? No, I don't. I'm making a pause.
You know, we played in Frankfurt, and Janice was freaking out. We peeped out the curtain, and all of these dudes were sitting there with these little haircuts, like you put a bowl on their head and cut around the bowl.
Is everybody ready?
But we felt like playing. We said, hey, man, we played the show. If y'all want to boogie, come on up here with us and boogie.
Janice was on stage and things were going well. All was right with the world. But after that hour, you got to come off stage.
She used to say that it was like making love being on the stage, you know. But it's an illusion. When the show's over, the audience leaves. And you're left with yourself.
She rarely was using heroin before a concert because it wasn't the right kind of energy for on stage, and she cared about that. But her after the concert fix was a real regular thing.
We were devolving into this drug use that was way out of hand. I have to, you know, digress for a second and say, when Janice was in Big Brother, Peter didn't do any drugs, you know. So out of respect to him, you know, we kept it toned down a lot, you know. So now she's in Cosmic Blues, so we're doing really a lot of drugs, you know, because Peter's not, Daddy isn't there anymore, you know. We're free and we can do all these drugs now. so it really got out of hand, you know, in Los Angeles, in particular, the Landmark Hotel. She called me to her room and she said, your services are no longer needed, you know. And so then we shot up some hair and she said, well, aren't you going to ask me why, you know? I said, what difference does it make? It was just like a marriage, you know, had run out of juice, and a lot of our friends were dying that year. She's lying on a motel bed and she says, it's not going to happen to me. She said, my people are pioneer stock, you know, and they came across the country and they came to Texas. They're tough, you know. I've got those genes and nothing's going to happen to me. And I just went, shit, I wish you wouldn't have said that. You know.
Trust in me, baby. Give me time, give me time.
Woodstock from pretty well in advance, and we thought, oh great, it's the next Monterey. It's a very warm summer day, and all this variety of choppers are taking off and landing. I do remember that Peggy was on the airlift zone where we took off from. I was always apprehensive when Peggy was around because I felt that she would be an enabler rather than a helper with the drug problem.
She called and said, you have to come. I said, I can't, because we were hearing reports that the turnpike was bogged down and people were out of gas and having babies, and, you know, it was like locusts coming through, you know. And so I said, the only way I'd come out there is if I was airlifted in. And she said, okay. We were both around the same age in the South, with middle-class families, but I think Janice had a harder time of coming through. But on the other hand, you know, people tend to think because of that, that she was depressed. She wasn't. It was all fun. We shot heroin for fun, and it took the edge off. We were in the midst of one of the most social phenomenons in history.
What I understand is she got very high, shooting up in the Portisan, and couldn't go on. Finally, Peggy and John Cook had to push her on stage.
How are you out there? Are you out? Are you okay? You're not, you're staying stoned and you got enough water and you got a place to sleep and everything. Because, you know, because we ought to, all of us, you know, I don't mean to be preachy, but we ought to remember, and that means promoters too, that music's for grooving, man, and music's not for putting yourself through bad changes. You know, I mean, you don't have to go take anybody's, man, just to like music. You know what I mean? You don't. So if you're getting more than you deserve, you know what to do about it, man.
Walk me love.
games that you play with yourself to turn yourself on. Mm. You can usually get yourself going.
You never had a desire to just leave the stage and say, I'm sorry it isn't working tonight, folks?
It's the best thing ever happened to me. I wouldn't leave.
Yeah. If you couldn't do it anymore, you'd be miserable, huh?
Yeah, I hope that by that time I'll have something else that's as groovy.
This is the dark time in my time with Janis. Albert and Janis reached a point where they said, well, we're going to let the Cosmic Blues Band dissipate.
Janis took that failure on herself. She felt that she was failing. And this was, as a result, by far the worst abuse of heroin and alcohol.
Happened to me, you see, this whole success thing, it hasn't yet really compromised the position that I took a long time ago in Texas. That was to be true to myself, to be the person that that was on the inside of me and not play games. I said, that's what I'm trying to do mostly in the whole world, is to not bull myself.
When I saw her in the hotel, all of the uncertainties and the little girl lost were very visible. And, you know, she said, come on up and we'll order drinks from room service. And I hadn't been there very long when she decided to shoot up. And I'd never seen her do that before. And then, you know, we had some drinks, we talked, and she did it again before I left. When I left, I thought, I don't know if I will want to see her again.
What do you think when you're singing? Are you actually thinking what's going on in the song, or can your mind be somewhere else?
I'm not really thinking much. You're just sort of trying to feel.
Yeah. When last I heard of you, you were in the jungles of Brazil.
I went to Rio for a carnival, and then I decided to hitchhike around the northern part of Brazil.
As a kind of vacation?
Just like a regular old beatnik on the road.
I knew I was going to try to make it to Rio for Carnival because I was meeting a friend of mine, so I got to Rio a couple days early. And I thought, God, there's Ipanema Beach, you know. God, the girl from Ipanema, you know. So I went over to Ipanema Beach, and the very first person I ran into on the beach was Janis. So I didn't know it was Janis. I just saw this girl with a bikini on.
Why I need a man to love.
she looked up. I remember lifting her sunglasses up and saying, "Hi, you cute thing." And I went, "Wow, hi, you cute thing. I've been in the jungle a long time." Night, she wasn't sleeping well, she was rolling around, she was unhappy, she was having cold sweats, and she told me that she was trying to kick the habit. So I held her for 2.5 days while she came down. She was a really different person. She was much more calm, she was much more beautiful. I mean, and she wasn't used to being straight, so she knew she was more beautiful. And then after that, everything was clear. She couldn't have gotten higher when we traveled around Brazil. She was so free and so different than any other girl I'd ever met. I'd never had a woman inspire me before. So it stopped me in my tracks, so to speak. I was heading for North Africa, and when I met her, I realized, I'm not going anywhere. When we came back to California, we more spent time together, just the two of us. I mean, we did come to the park here, and we did go to the Hague, but basically, we just pretty much hung together. We were inseparable, really, for those months. As my relationship with Janis grew, I realized that when she sang me all these songs, they were always the blues. And that's what she felt, basically, were the blues. She could feel everybody's pain. That's one of the reasons she did heroin, was so she didn't have to be involved with everybody else's life. Most people can be oblivious to what's going on around them, but Janis couldn't. She couldn't block it out. But she was addicted to it, you know, and I got her to stop, and then when I would go away, she'd get weak, I guess, is one way to say it, you know, and start it again. I told her, I can't do that part. I can't put up with that because it's killing you, and it broke my heart to see. That's really what it is. It broke my heart more than anything. When I said I was leaving, she said, "Why don't you stay and become my manager?" And it was a tempting offer, but the heroin I couldn't even begin to put up with.
Good God, that man finally done got in. Lord, that man finally
tune she just sang?
It's about men.
It's about men.
Did you ever see those mule carts?
Yeah.
There's a dumb mule up there, right? And they have a long stick with a string and a carrot hanging in it. And they hang this thing out in front of the mule's nose, mm-hmm. and he runs after it all day long.
And who's the man in this parable? The mule or the person holding the carrot?
The woman is the mule,
and
chasing
the
something that somebody's always teasing.
Constantly chasing
her with
a man.
Yeah.
Who always eludes her?
Well, they just always hold up something more than they're prepared to give.
We had dinner one night. And I remember suddenly saying, not having planned to, "How can you assure me that you're not taking, that you're not doing heroin?" And her answer was interesting. It was, "Who would care?" It really stopped me.
Do you ever get back to Port Arthur, Texas?
No, but I'm going back next in August, man. I guess what I'm doing.
I don't know.
I'm going to my 10th annual high school reunion.
I want to take movies and bring them back.
Hey, would you like to go?
Well, I don't remember. I don't have that many friends in your high school class. So.
I don't either.
Or mine, for that matter.
I don't either, believe me.
You don't either? No, they won't move the reunion now that you're going to ask them for it.
That's true. I wasn't going to tell them.
What do you remember most about Port Arthur?
I don't really remember. No comment.
Because it was really only the acceptance of millions that could make up for that way that she had grown up. If everyone loved her, then it was okay. But if anyone didn't, they could destroy her in a minute.
How were you different from your schoolmates when you were in DJ?
I don't know. Why don't you ask them?
In other words, was they who made you different?
No,
In other words, you were different in comparison to them, or were you?
I felt apart from them.
Did you go to football games?
I don't remember. I think not. I didn't go to the high school prom. And
you were asked, weren't you?
No, I wasn't. They didn't think. I don't think they wanted to take me. And I've been suffering ever since. I remember me when I was young. Some doctor told my mother that if I didn't, quote, straighten up, quote, I was going to end up either in jail or in insane asylum by the time I was 21, right? So when I turned 25 and my second record came out, I think my mother sent me a congratulatory telegram or something, you know, that I had escaped the pen.
How do you get along with your parents?
Pretty good.
Well, they got somewhere to go.
Right, they went to a wedding dance.
Oh,
we get along pretty good. Yeah.
They ever seem surprised by your success?
I think, yeah.
Our parents saw it as, challenging to their way of life, to their positions in the community, and it created difficulties between them, and both of them silently with each other, feeling that they had, somehow caused a calamity.
Good to me. He wants to come back and marry me. I thought invent it, and who knows? I may get tired of the music biz, but I'm really getting it on now.
She called me up and said, I got a great new band. You want to come back on the road?
With Janice, it was magic. She had a gift from God when she played. There was a connection there that I don't even know what it was between us. Somehow, we didn't really do a lot. We never did a lot of talking. She was a bubbly person. She wanted everything to be so perfect for everyone, not just her, everyone.
You say that it's over, baby. You say that it's over, dear. But still you hang around.
She said, man, with Full Tilt, I can change something in the middle of a song, and they're right there.
She was fantastic front person. She would say, when I do the windmill, keep her going. Or we'd be playing a song and she would decide she would like to talk to the audience and she would bring the band down and then she would start talking.
I can't hear you!
She was working the crowd.
Hey, you say
it wasn't just that she was clean. She had learned just about every lesson to be learned from the really tough times of the year before. She was more comfortable about her whole life.
Having David leave her was actually really good for her. She spoke of him afterwards as her lost love. She still hoped that he would come back after she got clean.
Kick, man. 4 months ago, I'm on the road rocking with a great group, so I get Janice back. She's delightfully crazy, but I love it, man. I've got that picture of us in Salvador, and every time I look at it, I look like a woman, not a pop star. But I'm afraid it's too late. I know how to be a pop star, but I don't know how to bake bread. But honey, when I look at you, this whole flood comes over me. I love you, and I did right, mother. Don't you yell at me.
Seems to bother a lot of women's lib people that you're kind of so upfront sexually.
I haven't been attacked by anyone yet. You know, how can they attack me? I'm representing everything they say they want, you know. It's sort of like you are what you settle for, do you know what I mean? You are only as much as you settle for. And if, you know, if they settle for being somebody's dishwasher, that's their own problem. If you don't settle for that and you keep fighting, man, you know, you'll end up anything you want to be. I just doing what I want to and what feels right and not settling for bullshit, and it works. How can I be mad at that?
Yeah. One girl I know said, well, how come she doesn't have any women in any of her groups?
You show me a good drummer and I'll hire one. You know, show me a good chick. Besides that, I want a chick for the road with me.
You don't?
I got enough competition, man. No, I like to be around men.
God bless you, folks. God bless you. These love true beauty.
It was fun getting back together with her on the Festival Express because we were all stuck in a little area. Her yes men couldn't contain her there. They couldn't control her there because she wanted to get out and be with her kindred spirits, the musicians.
We're stopped.
Hey, we're in Alberta.
Maybe we ought to run out and take a look.
Alberta.
Alberta, let your
Alberta,
hair hang
don't
there.
Let your hair hang there. No.
Man, we're all so stopped, man. We can get off the train and go and buy
no folks in Alberta.
I've loved you ever since the day I saw you.
Jerry didn't love Janice because she was a Sports Illustrated swimsuit model. he loved her for what she did. And the sparks that she threw off, he had a right proper appreciation for what Janis was and what she had to offer.
Gave me a demo of her singing Bobby McGee. It was so exhilarating for me to hear her make that her song. If you're a songwriter and somebody does that with what you got, it's the greatest feeling in the world.
Making a new record.
Yeah, it's really going good. I like my producer. He's really working out very well with me.
Who's producing it?
Paul Rothschild.
You haven't worked with him before, huh?
No, I haven't.
The first time I talked to Janis about Paul, she said, "Boy, that guy." And I said, "What?" And she started talking about him. And this is serious Janis. And I had never heard her say this kind of stuff about anybody. She was talking about how much she was learning from him.
Mood was very up. I mean, as good as sessions get. Everybody in love with everybody else and working very hard. And Janis, you know, she was always ready to do the most. She was a much better singer than the world or even she knew.
Oh, we knew there was something here. And that was all really, that whole thing was spontaneous combustion because she had an incredible sense of time. You listen to that stuff and like I tell you, it's like you're breathing. And the slowing down, and it's like being in heaven.
What he was asking her to do was to understand the different voices she had at her command. And the ramifications for this, for Janis, were really profound. Because she had always said, and she absolutely meant it, "Oh man, when I blow out my voice, I'm going to buy a bar and retire in Marin County." What she was learning from Paul was enabling her to see farther into the future. And that's where Paul was looking all along. He said, 30 years from now, I want you to be making your best album, and I want you to be making it with me.
She called me on the phone, and she said, "I got to play on the phone for you a song of Kris Kristofferson's that I've just recorded." To hear that voice, to hear her pride, to hear her excitement. I didn't hear it till she was gone. And it was very emotional for me, you know. I could just see her saying, "Wait, that son of a bitch hears this," you know.
You know, everything about it was positive for Janis, except that she always hated the down hours. The Janis who says, "How come the guys in the band go home, you know, with these girls and I go home alone?" She was saying, "You can't imagine how hard it is to be me."
She just didn't know who to relax with. She just didn't know anymore. A lot of pressure. You gotta do this, Janis. You gotta do that. That's what made it hard for her, I think. She loved everybody. That was the problem. She was like a little girl lost, and then she would be as strong as a mountain lion.
As far as anyone could see, she had kicked heroin. She'd replaced it with alcohol, but it didn't look like that was going to kill her. I think she just thought one last little hurrah. I can understand her wanting to, you know, no one's ever going to know. I'll hang in my room, do a hit, and then go to bed.
Paul Rothschild called me and he said, Janice isn't here. Can you see if you can find her?
And I pull out of the driveway and I just look up there and I know which window is hers and there's a light in the window.
And when I opened the door, I had this really simple and direct feeling, nobody's here. I came around the corner and saw Janice lying by the bed. But that feeling of nobody is here, it was right.
Standing at the stove, boiling an egg or something, the radio said Janis Joplin, and I knew before they got the last consonant in her name out that she was dead.
Same alone. Could meet you in Kathmandu anytime, but late October is the best season. Love your mama more than you know.
I just fell apart. I just completely fell apart. She was in touch with her own emotions and her who she was. In some way that nobody else that I knew was that in touch with. And to be that way, to try to get that, that's the price you pay for doing that kind of art on that level, you know.
Dear family, I'm awfully sorry to be such a disappointment to you. But I really do think there's an awfully good chance I won't blow it this time. There's really nothing more I can say right now. Guess I'll write more when I have more news. Until then, address all criticism to the above address. And please, believe that you can't possibly want for me to be a winner more than I do. Love, Janice.
Did you mean when you said that? So I was putting a little bit
bit of my own feelings because of my own situation of writing my own family letters. I remember what it was like to feel that feeling of, I'm going to write this to them, you know, will they understand it, will they accept me, you know, do they like me more, you know, do they think that I'm not the black sheep because I'm telling them this cool information that makes me feel good about myself. I was looking at the footage before I do the read, and, you know, it would fill me with feelings, knowing the things that were going on in her life at that time. And I remember the last letter, I couldn't catch my breath because I was crying, because for her to still apologize for who she was and what she couldn't be for her family was really hard, and to realize that she, you know, maybe when she passed, she still didn't feel like she had accomplished what she wanted, you know, which I guess was love and acceptance for being herself. A Woman Left Lonely is probably in the top three of my favorite songs to sing that I've ever sung.
Hearing Janis sing it
just moves you. It moves every woman, I think, who's been left alone. And men, of course, as well, can relate to it because that's what she did so well. She could just move everybody.
She stood up there, and the more she got thousands of people on their feet stand, you know, you got to get up, you got to respond, be with me, show me, you know, that the more she did that, the more she made people come to a sense of their own inner challenge.
Lord, take it on down. Take it on down. Something now. Something there.
And for women, it was really a time of being able to dream individual dreams. And Janis gives them an inner friend, kind of an inner voice that says, yes, yes, you can do what you want to do. And go do it now.
Oh.
need ya. I got to have it cause I want you, need ya. I got to have it cause I'm mama, man, mama.
She, like, took a flag and made a place in rock and roll for women. She was the first to really feel that crazy light of what rock and roll was at the time.
Women were way ballsier then than they are now, and Janis was fearless with her pain and with her truth, and that was one of the most inspiring things for me, watching her going, oh, okay, I don't need to be anything other than who I am.
She must have had a lot on her plate because it's the late 60s. We all see the footage now. It gives the illusion of free love and barriers being broken, but that's not really the case. Nobody had seen that kind of visceral rock and roll singing from a female. And to perform that way with those lyrics and those songs, and to feel there's no lie in it, it is like you might as well be slashing yourself on stage and opening your skin.
No one before or since, in my opinion, has ever been what Janis was on stage. It was the closest thing to God that, if you didn't have religion in your life, that you could experience. Gospel in church, and to hear real gospel singers sing, it's a spiritual experience. And Janis was a spiritual experience. If I had one wish, I'd be at one of those performances. That would be the thing I missed in my life.
I really started getting into Janis. I was playing in these bars. And I'm like, okay, I can relate to what she did. I wanna sing with her energy. I don't need to sing like her. I don't wanna look like her. I want to have that passion. I don't wanna be afraid. I don't wanna be afraid of my sexuality. So I'm playing in women's bars at this time. And I start singing Peace of My Heart, and the place goes crazy because it's an energy that I can settle into. If it's a dream, I don't want
nobody to wake me. She spoke to me. She had that raw, electric energy. You didn't see it often then, and you don't see it that often today in a performer.
Janis is famous for saying, I make love to 10,000 people every night and I go home alone. She was making real music, and there was nothing else in her life that was working, nothing.
She's trying to live it, and you cannot live what you are on stage in the normal world.
You've been dancing with God for 2 hours, and you're feeling everything, and it's all okay. And then you jump on the bus, and it's quiet, and there's nobody, and they've left a bottle of wine on the table for you, and there's a candle lit, and you're like this, and you've got to calm yourself down, and you've got to get some sleep, and you've got to do it all again tomorrow.
Support for American Masters is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, Rosalind P. Walter, the Blanche and Irving Laurie Foundation, Ralph and Elizabeth Rosenthal, Vital Projects Fund, Rhoda Herrick, Jack. Elizabeth Kertész Foundation, Michael and Helen Schaefer Foundation. Funding for this program provided by Ellen and James S. Marcus, the Philip and Janice Levin Foundation, Judith and Burton Resnick, Lenore Hecht Foundation, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. Janis Joplin and other American Masters. Visit pbs.org/American Masters or find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Tumblr. Janis, Little Girl Blue is available on DVD. The companion soundtrack is also available. To order, visit shoppbs.org or call 1-800-PLAY-PBS.